this is some Max Hitterrod, remastered in HD. Now, before you get too excited, nope, there hasn't been an official HD remaster announced for this classic 1993 point-and-click adventure. This is my personal project where I traced over this iconic scene using the free vector software Inkscape and the Godot engine to put it in an interactive mockup. In this video, I'll show you how you can use the power of vector graphics to create an HD remaster of any pixel game you may want. I'll walk you through my entire process, share the tools I used, and give you tips I learned along the way. If you're a Sonic 2 fan like me, you've probably been keeping an eye on the amazing fan-made HD remaster that's coming up. But what you may not know is that the project apparently was made using vector tools, and it works like a charm for the graphics of Sonic 2. This got me thinking, could the same approach work for the more detailed, painterly adventure games? I wanted to test this by tackling one of those gorgeous LucasArts Sierra adventures from the early 90s. Games with incredible art that's trapped in those tiny 320 by 240 resolutions. While games like Day of the Tentacle and Full Throttle have gotten official HD remasters, I wanted to try something that hasn't been touched yet. So I choose one of my all-time favorites, Sam & Max Hit the Road. But first, we need a bit of understanding of what makes a game suited for a vector remaster, because not all games will work nicely with this approach. Back in the 80s and 90s, pixel art wasn't so much a deliberate style as it was a technical limitation. Games could be trying to emulate anything from photorealism to cartoon styles, but they were all forced into low resolutions. For vector remastering, games with clear, cartoony shapes work best. Sam & Max sits in an interesting middle ground. It has those strong cartoon shapes and simple lighting, but also contains subtle textures that can prove to be challenging to recreate. Still, this is doable, but I wouldn't go for something more detailed and realistic than this. But before starting the actual tracing, I just revived my old Instagram account. If you want to see extra content like mini tutorials or behind the scene bits that don't make it into the videos, go follow me there. And while you're at it, why not like this video, subscribe and drop a comment. It really helps the channel. Okay, let's start the tracing of the background. And the first thing I want to say is that I learned a lot with this project. I've never traced an entire background before. I was used to tracing over my own drawings that I do with my tablet, so I assumed that it would be something similar. Turns out I was completely wrong. I wasted a ton of time, and I mean a ton. This entire project took me about 10 hours of tracing, and I feel I could have saved at least 4 with the right method. The mistake was that I tried using my usual character tracing workflow, working on layers below the reference with filled shapes. For a complex, fully colored background, this was a nightmare, constantly fighting to select the right shape through all that visual noise and stopping every 5 seconds to sample colors and reorder shapes. The breakthrough came when I switched to tracing over the reference with simple lines first, focusing on completed small sections at a time and adding color and finalizing everything in a second pass. This made everything faster and mentally clearer. A very common problem that arises as you attempt to trace over is that because the reference is so low resolution, there may be areas where you can't tell what a shape is supposed to be. Like for example, take a look at these bars, the connection with the wall. If you zoom right in, you see that they are a group of 9 pixels. This doesn't really have all the information needed to clearly communicate how this object is connected to the wall. When you see a low resolution image like this, because of that lack of information, your brain does a lot of work to fill in the gaps. But now you need to do it in HD. There is no filling of gaps. You have to draw the shape explicitly. The same with the newspapers that are falling off the mailbox. I can't even tell how many there are. Or the cracks on the corner of the sidewalk. If you zoom in, you'll notice that there is not a well-defined shape to follow. All of this means that you'll have to make it up, and information where there isn't. And if you need, you should supply that lack of information with extra reference. A related problem is what happens here on this wall. Some things that work in pixel art will definitely not work in vector form in HD. I got no idea what those lines are supposed to be. I guess they imply some highlight in the bricks in the dark area. This will not work in vector form. Here's where you have to make a decision of how much accurate you'd like your art to look. In this case, I decided these lines took away more than what they added, and I decided they will not be in the trace over. One thing I found immediately is that an HD remaster requires hundreds of these little judgment calls, deciding what to keep, what to change, and how to stay faithful while making it work in a new medium. Like I said earlier, I've never done this type of full background traceover, and I was a bit naive with the times. I expected to finish a background in, at most, 3 hours. I wanted to make the first 3 backgrounds of the game and then publish a quick demo you could play, but I was so wrong. This single background plus the characters took me like 10 hours or more, and I couldn't justify that time on the other ones. So this made me question, is vector art too slow for this? Is mouse drawing impractical? And here's the thing. This is primarily an Inkscape channel. So when I do these tests and challenges, I limit myself to using only Inkscape, even if there are better tools for the job. In a real project, I mix in raster tools like Krita to complement the areas where Inkscape will not do, like textures, for example. So I decided to make a quick test to see if tracing entirely in Krita would be considerably faster to the point it would make tracing in Inkscape obsolete. I actually started to record myself and all, but I immediately realized that it was actually slower than Inkscape, especially if you use my technique of working in line first and adding the colors later. So I never end up finishing that background. So yes, remastering with vectors is overall faster, at least for this type of backgrounds, though combining tools will be ideal. Okay, a quick word about fonts. I could have used a similar looking typeface, but in my experience finding perfect matches is really hard and time consuming and never looks exactly the same. So I decided to trace each letter manually. It was way slower, but it looks so much better than using some generic letters that don't fully fit. The textures were the one thing that worried me the most about this project. As you may know, Inkscape is not ideal for textures. First is the texture of the red building. This was surprisingly easy to do and looked almost identical to the reference. Maybe the original artist followed a similar process than I did. I just used this texture from an open game art pack of textures. It worked like a charm using the lighting mode. I'm actually surprised how close it got to the original. The grunge and dirtiness textures all over the building and sidewalks and signs were a bit more complicated. A simple texture won't do. I decided to stick entirely to Inkscape and use my textures pack, which contains over 170 vector textures I made by hand. It is available in my Inkscape Jumpstart pack, which has a few other interesting goodies that can help you get started with Inkscape. It's absolutely free, link in the description. Now it's just a matter of using my textures to spread them strategically all over, so they look as close to the original as possible. Being vector textures, it will never look 100% like the reference. Sometimes you have to embrace that your copy is not gonna look 100% identically, and that is not something bad. Very often the vector medium imposes its limitations on you, and you have to either work around them or embrace them. In the case of the textures, I think they look similar enough, and more importantly, it looks good on its own, which is what is important in the end. And now the final step, which is tracing over the sprites. This will be on its own layer in the engine. Some of them will be animated and the other, like the scar, will be static, but the playable character Sam will be able to go in front and behind. There's nothing new here, I'm following the exact same process than before, tracing on top and then coloring on a second pass. By this moment, I became quite fast and effective at tracing, and I'm finishing way faster. This is the great thing about these projects, is that even if you're not drawing something new, you always learn something that you can reuse in your projects. In this case, I was able to immediately get the correct order of the complex shapes of the car in a second, something that would have taken me much more time to do if I didn't went through all of those hours of trace before. Then there are the characters. I found these sprites in the same place I found all the art, in the Spriters resource. Great page, by the way, which as far as I know has sprites ripped directly from the games themselves. They look a bit too wide for me, but I'll fix that later on. A couple of notes here. As you can see, the sprite sheets has a ton of animations. For walking alone, it has a top, down, and side version, and some very complex idle animations. In the game, Sam and Max walk together, but Max often moves around the scene on its own. I decided, in order to save time, and because this is just a humble demo, that I would only move Sam, and Max will stay static in the corner. Also, I simplified Sam's movement by only making him have a single idle frame and only a walk left and right animation. I think the end result looked good, and you can barely tell there are animations missing. Anyway, this time I followed the same process than before, but now there is line art. That means I have to pay attention to what are the pixels trying to convey, what directions and thickness. Again, all that information is missing here, and you have to reconstruct it in your head, just by looking at the art. By the way, I'm using the bucket tool technique that I love to use with characters. You'll know what I mean if you're a regular of the channel. It's a super fast technique to trace over characters without complicating yourself with solid shapes. In this case, even if the characters are animated, it's done frame by frame, and that means we can use the bucket tool technique to save some time. Other than that, the only problem that came out was that I felt the Sam illustration felt a bit flat. I was constantly tempted to add some shadow or thicken the lines at some places, but I restricted myself to the most literal translation of the pixel art to the vector form as possible, adding shadow and thickness only where it was on the pixel art. I was committed to make a remaster, not a remake, of the assets, and there were so many areas where I was tempted to improvise. And here is it, the final background and the characters. All of this was done with minimal knowledge of Inkscape. So if you want to remaster your own games, even for games like graphical adventures, it is not that difficult. All you need is a basic understanding of the concepts behind vector illustration, which of course you can get in my channel. I have a ton of free step-by-step tutorials, there's even an entire Inkscape mini course to get you up and running as fast as possible. But if you really want to further accelerate your learning, I can recommend you my 13 courses pack. That's over 70 hours of Inkscape tutorials going over character design, background design, game art, and more. You'll be remastering your favorite games in no time. Right now it's on sale, link in the description. By purchasing this pack, you're helping me and the channel come out with more free tutorials and resources. Anyway, this is the end result in the game engine. I think it's quite convincing as a remaster of the game. It certainly looks better than an AI upscale. I know because somebody upscaled this exact background and it just doesn't look right. And yes, it is true, some of the finer details got lost in the translation to vector form, but I think it looks great on its own and it's hyper faithful anyway. So that was it for this video. Please don't forget to like and subscribe for more videos on Inkscape and game art. And let me know in the comments what other games should I replicate or even remaster in the future. I know I have some ideas in mind, but I would really like to see your suggestions. That's all, see you next week. Bye!